Well, good morning, church family. I want to welcome you to this Sabbath morning. What a beautiful day we have, and it's so good to see all my brothers and sisters.
Please stand with me as we sing our opening hymn, He Leadeth Me.
He leadeth me, O blessed thought, O words with heavenly comfort fraught. Whate'er I do, where'er I be, still 'tis God's hand that leadeth me. He leadeth me, He leadeth me, by His own hand He leadeth me. His faithful follower I would be, for by His hand He leadeth me. Sometimes mid scenes of deepest gloom, sometimes where Eden's bowers bloom, by water still or troubled sea, still 'tis God's hand that leadeth me. He leadeth me, He leadeth me, by His own hand He leadeth me. His faithful follower I would be, for by His hand He leadeth me. Lord, I would clasp my hand in Thine, nor ever murmur nor repine. Content whatever lot I see, since 'tis my God that leadeth me. He leadeth me, He leadeth me, by His own hand He leadeth me. His faithful follower I would be, for by His hand He leadeth me. And when my task on earth is done, when by Thy grace the victory's won, in death's cold wave I will not flee, since God through Jordan leadeth me. He leadeth me, He leadeth me, by His own hand He leadeth me. By His faithful follower I would be, for by His hand He leadeth me.
Please bow your heads with me. Our dear Heavenly Father, we thank You so much for this beautiful Sabbath day that we can enter into Your courts with praise. We can also bring our cares and petitions before You. But most of all, as we begin our worship service, we want to invite You into this house, and that our praise and our prayers and the word spoken will uplift You and glorify You. We thank You so much for Your love and Your care for us, and I just ask that You would bless each one here today, that they will receive the blessing that You have in store for them. Be especially with the Curtises as they share their testimony, and may each one of us be inspired to realize that we each have a testimony that we can share that will bring others closer to You, and to just bring that knowledge of what You have done into other people's lives and realize, hey, there is a God out there that loves them. And so I just am so grateful for Your love and for Your care, and ask that You would go with us in our service now. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
So the offering today is for church budget. And of course, what that means is we're collecting monies for the church to pay the monthly bills. That's the light bill and the accessories we have and so forth. So the Lord loves a cheerful giver, and it's for a good cause, is to support our church, the church that we have here in the facility. So let us pray. Our Father in heaven, we ask that you bless this offering. We ask that those who give, they give cheerfully, and we ask that the monies that are collected go far and wide and pay for our bills and keep us in this nice facility. We ask, Lord, that you bless all those who are in this church this morning and be with them throughout the day and the week. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning. How are you guys? What are your names? Oh, that's a pretty name. So is Evangeline. Ooh, nice names. My name is Chris. And when I was working, I was a veterinary technician. And I worked in a place that dealt with large animals, like horses and cattle and sheep and goats, and dogs and cats and little gophers, all kinds of little animals too. Well, today I'm going to tell you about a special experience I had with a lamb. A gentleman named Mr. Phillips came in, and he had a sheep that was dying, and she was very pregnant. And she was so weak, she couldn't deliver the baby on her own. She couldn't push it out. So the vet came in, and he says, well, Chris, we're going to have to do, we're going to have to take the baby through surgery. So would you please get her ready? So I did. And he says, you got your spot ready? I said, yes, my spot's right at the back of the room. It's all ready, which was a blanket on the floor. And then I also had with me a little bottle. And this is to get the mucus out of the animal's throat. And then a little blanket for the lamb. So we came in, and he did his part of the surgery, and he handed the lamb to me. It was all covered with whatever is in there, all the mucusy stuff and blood that's inside the mom. And just as he handed the lamb to me, the mama died. So it was just in time when we took him out. Otherwise, he may have died inside. God was very good. And the owner said, this is the last lamb he's going to get from his ram. His ram was considered to be the most perfect in the state of Idaho. And he was so anxious to get that lamb alive so that he could maybe replace the dad. And it happened to be he was born a boy. So he was going to get to take care of this farmer. This farmer did not like religion. He did not like Jesus. He didn't like to hear anything about Christ. So they told me when I came back, whatever you do, don't say anything that's on a religious note. And I said, okay. So I was holding that lamb and rubbing it like crazy with the blanket to get the anesthetic out of his body so he could start breathing better. And finally, he took a breath, and I started crying. Do you know why? Because lambs, back in Jesus' day, and this thought came to me, their head was raised up, and their life was taken from them to pay for somebody's sins. Not every lamb, of course, but some lambs had to have that happen. So I thought about that, and that lamb might have died for my sins, not to save my life, but because I sinned, not because somebody's going to hurt me. That seems so unfair to me. So I was crying, but I was trying to be very quiet so that the man didn't, I didn't have to explain to him why I was feeling the way I was. So the vet asked me, he says, what's wrong, Chris? Did it die? And I said, no, he's fine. And he said, well, what's wrong? I said, I'll tell you later. So after the man was gone, then he came over and talked to me. He says, what happened? And I said, nothing. Everything went well. I just thought about this lamb happened to pay the cost for my sins, but like what happened in Jesus' time. But you know what the good news is? We don't have to worry about that anymore because Jesus gave his life for us. So no lamb ever again has to die because of my mistakes or your mistakes. Isn't that wonderful news? Yeah. So I want you to remember what a wonderful thing Jesus did for us. He gave his life to save us from our sins. So we should thank him. Would you want to do that with me for it real quick? Do you want to pray? Okay.
Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for that we're at your Sabbath school, and thank you for saving that lamb. And in Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Thank you so much. You may go back to your seat.
Thank you very much, Chris. That was a beautiful story. I'd like to invite you to join in singing our praise song this morning, Father, Lead Me Day by Day. It's hymn number 482. I'd like to invite you to turn over to hymn number 466, Wonderful Peace. 466.
Of my spirit tonight rolls a melody sweeter than song. In celestial like strains it unceasingly falls, o'er my soul like an infinite calm. Peace, peace, wonderful peace, coming down from the Father above. Sweep over my spirit forever, I pray, in fathomless billows of love. What a treasure I have in this wonderful peace, buried deep in my innermost soul. So secure that no power can mine it away, while the years of eternity roll. Peace, peace, wonderful peace, coming down from the Father above. Sweep over my spirit forever, I pray, in fathomless billows of love. Leave when I rise to that city of peace, face I shall see. That one strain of the song which the ransom will sing in that heavenly kingdom will be. Peace, peace, wonderful peace, coming down from the Father above. Sweep over my spirit forever, I pray, in fathomless billows of love. I believe when I rise to that city of peace, where the author of peace I shall see. That one strain of the song which the ransom will sing in that heavenly kingdom will be. Peace, peace, wonderful peace, coming down from the Father above. Sweep over my spirit forever, I pray, in fathomless billows of love. Amen.
Thank you. That was very nice. Well, before I get into the scripture reading, I just want to talk a little bit about what's going on this Sabbath. And I'll do the scripture reading, and then I'll introduce our speakers. So this is the fifth Sabbath of this month. This happens once every 3 months, once every quarter, and four times a year. And our church traditionally and generally reserves this for testimonies. And I've heard several testimonies over the past 4 years, usually by our own brothers and sisters. And these folks come from our own church. It is always interesting and so often inspiring. Sometimes there's an emotional impact. Our testimony is our own story. No one knows it better than the person who experienced it. It is your oral declaration, and it is generally includes your life before Jesus, or your conversion, or those events that brought you to the Lord, and also life after the conversion. For those raised as Christians, in other words, they were born into a family that were Christians, it could be when they truly gave their heart to the Lord, or when they were helped with guidance from the Lord, direction through a crisis or stress or tribulation. And last, it could even be a life-changing decision that was made with the help of the Lord. The person given the testimony needs to realize the value of their testimony to themselves and to others. Testimony represents to us the coming to Christ. These are our personal stories, often sacred and usually very private. But a testimony can also bring others to Christ when we share our story. Yes, that story is between us and also God. But does not God want us to witness? Therefore, does he not want us to share? A testimony can breathe life into our being, encourage our hearts. The power of testimony can strengthen our faith, our hope in Christ. For the presenter of the testimony, it gives and grows our understanding of truth, often distilled from prayer and pondering of spiritual faith. A strong testimony can fortify your own personal walk with Christ. It gives witness, peace, comfort, and assurance to overcome the challenge of daily life. Our scripture reading today is from 2 Corinthians 9:8. And God is able to make all grace abound toward you, that you, always having all sufficiency in all things, may have an abundance for every good works. This Sabbath we are fortunate to have as our witness a husband and wife couple. and they will be sharing their testimony. They are long-term members of this church. They are quiet and reserved. So when they speak, their comments are always important and often inspiring. So it's my pleasure to introduce our brother and sister in Christ, Harold and Carolyn Curtis.
And yes, we will get Carolyn up here a little later. Going off what Ken just said, one of the reasons why I felt compelled, I guess I could say, to share a testimony is from listening to the testimonies that have been already been given in this church. And so if nothing else is accomplished from today, other than someone else is encouraged to give their testimony, I will be blessed. But I hope it's more than that. I hope you come to a bit of a closer walk with the Lord through these comments. When Ken, well, I guess I should say one other thing first. If I would have known this was Easter weekend when I was asked to do this weekend, I would have probably refused, because I think it would have been much better to have Jennifer and Aaron perhaps choose a number of hymns that we could all just sing together and praise the Lord. And I think that would have been a beautiful service, and I wish I would have known that and thought of that and said, no, I'm not going to do it. But when Ken asked me, I don't know if he saw hesitancy in my eyes about getting up in front and sharing, but he says, well, just if you want to, just bring your guitar and do some songs. Well, I'm not going to do that today. What I will do, though, is start my talk with a chorus that is in a kind of a contemporary Christian song, because I think it leads in well to what both Carolyn and I choose to share. Because as we thought about what we were going to share, the truth is the Lord has been way too good to us. We have too many things to share. And we didn't know where to start. Every time we thought of something, we'd say, but if we're going to share that, we would have to share this first. And so it became a bit of a difficulty for us to decide what we were going to share. But I will read these lines from this song, and it's from a song called My Story. Some of you may be familiar with it. And the chorus goes, if I should speak, then let it be of the grace that is greater than all my sin, of when justice was served and where mercy wins, of the kindness of Jesus that draws me in. Oh, to tell you my story is to tell of him. Let's bow our heads for another word of prayer. Father, we thank you for your grace, for your justice and your mercy, and for your kindness that ever draws us in. All we can do is lean on you. And today we just thank you that you're there for us. We thank you for your life, your death, your resurrection, and the life you're living for us now. And that you're there to argue our pathetic case on our behalf. Thank you again. In Christ's name, amen. Ken had also suggested that we might tell some stories about our experience either in Russia or how we even got there to begin with. But again, to understand that, you would have to know a lot of prehistory to that. And as we talked more and more, we realized that what we really needed to perhaps do is give a basis for how the Lord has even got us to the point we are today, and how he, over time, has been a guidance in our life. And to start with that, probably some of you remember back in high school biology, you were told of the minuscule possibility that you even exist, and that gave the details of how that might be. Well, there's a man by the name of Ali Benazir who took it kind of a step further than that. And I'm going to go through this with you, and I hope those of you that love numbers, well, I know you'll be engaged. Those of you who don't love numbers, I'll tell you when it's time to wake up, okay? First of all, Mr. Benazir said the probability of your parents even meeting to begin with, and this is based off of population and population movement and so forth, is about 1 in 20,000. That was his numbers that he came up with. But he said beyond that, even if they met, here's the probability that they'd actually fall in love. There is only a 1 in 10 chance, he says, that they would ever even talk to each other. There's only a 1 in 10 chance that ever make it to a second date. If they made it to that second date, there is only a 1 in 10 chance that they would keep on dating. And then he gives a kind of probably a lower number than that, but he says there's only about a 50-50 chance, in other words, a 1 in 2 chance that they'd actually get married and have a happy life together and have children. So you take all those numbers together, the 1 in 20,000, the 1 in 10, 1 in 10, 1 in 10, and you add those all together, and you end up with a 1 in 40 million chance that you even exist. Now, if you add in the biological side of that, and again, Mr. Benazir took it beyond the moment in time, but rather for the entire life of the parents during their childbearing years, and I won't go through all his rationale here, but basically he comes down to that you have a 1 in 400,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000, That's one in 400 quadrillion if you were counting the zeros. Now, if you get past about $1.75, you've lost me. So one in 400 quadrillion. 400 quadrillion is about the volume of the Atlantic Ocean in cubic meters. That gives you an idea of how vast one in 400 quadrillion is. But he doesn't stop there. He says, okay, what about previous generations? And he just, I think he probably pulled this one out of the air. He may have had some data behind it, but he says basically there's only about a one in two chance that any child will grow up to bear children. You multiply that, and he used this number, 150 generations, and I'm going, where did he get that number? And so I went back to the time of the flood, divided it by about 30 years of a generation, that's kind of often considered, and guess what you come up with? 150 generations. So there's been 150 generations since the time of Noah. You take all that, and you take in all these other things, and you end up, and I'll just cut to the chase here, you end up with a 1 in 10, and those of you that are scientific, you will know how this means. It's 1 in 10 to the 2 millionth 640th thousand possibility that you even are here today. But that isn't counting in that other part before of how your parents could have possibly even met. And so you multiply all that in there, and the total becomes 1 in 10 times the 280, is that right? No, 268, sorry, yes. 2,268,000 possibility that you are even here today. By comparison, the number of atoms in an average male of about 175 pounds is 10 to the 50th. And this will help you give an idea how those zeros multiply so fast, okay? So the amount of atoms about in me, let's say, is 10 to the 50th power. The number of atoms in the known universe, excuse me, in the Earth is only, I got this wrong, I'm sorry, I'm 10 to the 27th power. In the entire world is 10 to the 50th power. In the entire known universe is 10 to the 80th power. That's the atoms in the entire universe, and yet your probability of being here is 1 in 10 to the 2,800,000 685,000. And as Mr. Benazar went on to say, so the odds that you exist at all are basically zero. And then he went on to say this, and I thought it was very good. A miracle is defined as something that is so unlikely that it is virtually impossible. By that definition, we have shown that you are a miracle. Live like the miracle you are. However, God says something a bit different. Isaiah tells us that God claims to have formed the entire nation of Israel. So you take that times 10 to the millionth power there, multiply it times all the people in the nation of Israel, and imagine that. Isaiah also recognizes that God formed him specifically. Jeremiah, we all know this verse probably, Jeremiah says, that as God is speaking to Jeremiah, he said, before I formed you in the womb, so who's doing the forming? God is doing the forming. God is doing the forming through all those 150 generations. Now you think about that, to get you to where he wants and needs you right now. Jeremiah says, or God says, behold, I formed you in the womb, I knew you, and before you were born, I consecrated you. I appointed you a prophet to the nations. Now you may go, well, that doesn't apply to me, because I'm not a prophet. What is a prophet? Singers are actually considered prophets in the Bible. Why? Because they were the voice of God. They were sharing God's message with the people. Anytime you share with anyone at any level, you are a prophet of God. And God formed you and knew you and consecrated you to be his mouthpiece, to share his love with the world. Now, in Mr. Benazar's calculations, there were some things he actually left out. If you think about how the population can actually be minimized by natural disasters, by man-made disasters, we have fires, famines, floods, pandemics, wars, all of which minimize the population and takes it down so the possibility of you being here is even less. And there's one other thing. And I don't know what the worldwide figures are, but in the United States today, about one in every five children are aborted. You just, to exist in today's society in Western world, in the United States anyway, you have a 20% less chance than nothing of even being here. Now, I brought up that last one because I could have easily been one of those statistics. When my mother became pregnant with me, she had already lost a child. She had had other children successfully. But when she was carrying me, the doctor couldn't find a heartbeat. Now, there's argument even in the scientific world today of when you actually can hear a heartbeat. But typically, most people agree by 4 or 5 months, you should be hearing a heartbeat. There was no heartbeat. 6 months came along, guess what? No heartbeat. 7th month came along, still no heartbeat. If my mom had lived in Seattle and had a city slicker doctor, the doctor at this point would have been saying, we need to cut you open and get that horrible tumor out of you, because that's a growth that's growing inside you and it's disrupting your whole being and your bodily function. It's going to kill you. Let's get it out of there. Well, my mom didn't live in Seattle. She lived in Clear Lake, which was, I don't know, probably at that point, I'm probably exaggerating, on the upper side, might have been 100 people that lived there. She actually worked for the country doctor that cared for those people and the surrounding farmers and loggers and whatever else was there at the time. And so the doctor said, let's just wait. 8 months came along. Finally, he told my mom, he says, I think I hear a heartbeat. This is at 8 months. He thinks he hears a heartbeat. Well, when the 9th month came along, he wasn't willing, like with the lamb, to have this frail baby go through the birthing process. So my mom underwent a C-section, and I was brought out. And a little side issue on that story, some people wonder, how on earth did you ever get a name like Harold? That's such an old name. Well, my doctor's name was Harold. And that had something to do with it, I'm sure. But here we have science, and we went through all this of saying, you shouldn't even be here. And then God saying, no, I formed you. And I don't believe science, well, let me put it this way, I don't believe pure science and pure religion disagree with each other. I believe they complement each other. I believe we learn from both of them. So if we take those thoughts and we put them together, that we shouldn't even be here, that I shouldn't be here, especially I shouldn't be here, but you put into it that God formed me and knew me, that means he formed you and he wanted you, he formed me and he wanted me, and he has a purpose for each one of us. Jeremiah 29:11, another verse I'm sure you're familiar with, says, "For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans for welfare and not calamity, to give you a future and a hope." We often see that on plaques, on wall hangings, on t-shirts and hats. It's a very comforting thought and statement, but I challenge you to go read the story around that verse. Because what that verse is actually saying is when things go terribly wrong, God still has a plan for you. When things go terribly wrong because it's your own fault, God still has a plan for you. And he will do his best to work that out. And yes, I have made horrible mistakes in my life. And I often say that there is a mistake in the Bible. And that's because Paul claims that he's the chief of sinners. And I think he had it wrong because I'm the chief of sinners. But I also know that each of us, when we look at the cross that we celebrate this weekend, or we at least remember a little better this weekend, and everything that Christ went through for us, and then we look at ourselves, we go, wait a minute. When we take our eyes off of people around us and we look at Christ and we compare him to ourselves, we cannot say anything but we're the chief of sinners. That's who we are. And the Bible does tell us that we have all sinned. But it goes on to say, that, in fact, if you read that entire verse, it talks about all of us. There's no difference between those who think they're righteous and those who think they're sinners, those who actually might be doing a pretty good job at living and those who are horrible at it. It says, "For there is no difference, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God." But that's not where that verse ends either, even though that's often the part we quote. The verse goes on to say, and I'm gonna do I'm not good at this, but I'm going to do the quote diagramming of the sentence, and I'm going to take that one phrase out of there, and I'm going to say it this way. Still quoting the Bible. "For there is no difference being justified freely by his grace through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus." That's where we all stand. We have the choice of redemption. And, of course, then there's other verses such as that nothing can separate us from the love of God. And that is true. But what can we do without Christ? And the Bible tells us we can't do anything. We can do nothing unless we abide in Christ. As one author put it, and I think this is done very well, "But though you may be weak, erring, frail, sinful, and imperfect," that's me, "the Lord holds out to you the offer of partnership with himself, inviting you to come under divine instruction, uniting with Christ, you may work the works of God. Without me," Christ says, "you can do nothing." And here's a verse, if you haven't already memorized, do so, Philippians 4:13. "I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me." Now, I've kind of gone through the impossibilities of you and I being here genetically, so to speak. Carolyn's going to share another aspect that adds another nuance to us being not only here, but who we are.
I'm going to read that verse again that he just read. For I know the thoughts that I think towards you, says the Lord, thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you a future and a home. The journey that my family went through, when you think about the possibilities of me standing here today, are pretty slim. My father was born in Nebraska. And his parents moved him to up in near the Yakima area when he was six. My grandmother was I think both my grandparents were Adventists, but my grandmother was the kind of the rock. And when my dad was growing up, he was a typical boy. And by the time he got old enough to join the service, or he was drafted, he was not very well grounded in the church anymore. And so he went and served during World War II. And when he came back, he went to college. My mother was born and raised in Tacoma, Washington. It's near Seattle. However, my parents met in college in Pullman, Washington, which is near the Colorado or the Idaho-Washington border. It's like, why in the world did my mom go to college clear across the state? I was trying to look up today approximately how many students would have been there when they were attending, but I couldn't figure it out. There's 22,000 people, students, there this year. So back in 1946, 47, 48, there was probably 2,000 or 3,000. My mom came from a non-Christian home, and by then my dad was not claiming anything either. And I don't know how in the world they ever met to begin with. But they got married, and they had two children by the time Adventism ever even entered the picture. My mom got a flyer in the mail, and it was for some meetings, and it was put on by the Adventist Church, And, you know, the flyer had all these beasts and things on the front. And she's going, oh, this sounds, Mike, it might be kind of interesting to go to. And my dad's looking at that, and he knew what that was. And he's going, no, I don't think you'd be interested. And it looks pretty, you know. She said, well, I don't care if you want to go or not, but I want to go. So I think she went a couple of meetings by herself. And then he started going with her because she's coming home and she's telling him all this stuff. Well, those meetings lasted for 6 months. And I'm standing here today because of somebody that you guys probably know, Betty and Leon Cornforth, were responsible, in part, for those meetings. And they befriended my parents through that course. And they were friends their entire lives as a result of those meetings. You know, what are the odds of my parents ever meeting in the first place? Then getting married, then going to a series of meetings that my dad really didn't want to go to. And then the four children that my parents had. Still being in the church today. And the influence that my siblings have had in the work fields that they have chosen have had, I think, a tremendous impact on the communities that they live in, the churches that they attend. Both of my brothers have been very strong in the Pathfinder program over the years. My dad was, too, when we were growing up. And you never know the impact of the choices that you make long term. Each one of the decisions that you make is going to impact somebody else way down the line. But God knows, and He set all of that in motion. And He cares about each and every one of you. And the struggles and the trials that you go through, it may be to help someone else. It may be to make you a stronger witness, to make you stronger yourself. But ultimately, it's God's plan that you are put here for a reason. And you will never know the side of heaven, the ripple effect of each and every one of your lives. And what good you have done for someone else. So Don't give up. God loves you very much.
I know we haven't been necessarily telling stories on ourselves, but this is the basis of who God has developed it, us over time, and how we understand there's more to life than life. I thought if I had time, and I'm going to take the time, I will tell one little story from our experience in Russia. I don't know how many of you have been in larger cities like New York or Chicago or something and have ridden on the subways. In Moscow, they call them the metro. And I looked this up this morning, if I can remember, in the metro system in Moscow, they service an average of 9 million people a day. Was it 9 million? Okay, 9 million people a day. There are 288 different stations all over the metro system there in Moscow. If you divide that 900,000 or 9 million divided by the 288 stations, each station handles, and this is an average because some of the stations are very small and they're just picking up at the outskirts, and some of them are absolutely huge where they probably serve 500,000 people a day. No kidding, they are just enormous. But the average would be that each one of those 288 stations on that metro line, on those metro lines, would service approximately the population of Eagle every single day. Over 30,000 people every single day. That's a lot of people. Now, I tell you that to tell you this. We developed this routine as we were traveling in around the area, and especially in Moscow. Carolyn and our oldest daughter, Alicia, would always walk together. I would walk behind, holding our youngest daughter's hand, so I knew where Shannon was, and I knew where Carolyn and Alicia was, and that just made me feel comfortable. Okay, that was just my thing. Well, I believe we were at one of these larger stations. It was one of the hubs where a lot of lines come into, and we were having to transfer from one subway line or one metro line to another. And here we were walking through these thousands, tens of thousands, really, of people, through all this maze of people trying, and then you're always in a hurry to get to the next place. Because then you got to not only have to get on the metro, you have to get to the train in time so you can catch the train so you can get back home. Because we had to take the train into Moscow. So we were always in a hurry to do this stuff. And here I was walking along, and I'm going, okay, there's Carolyn, there's Alicia. And all of a sudden, I said, where is Shannon? And in that split second, my thoughts were, somebody has grabbed my daughter. What is my daughter going through? She doesn't know the language. She's scared to death. She doesn't know where her parents are. And so I yelled out to Carolyn, and she was a few steps ahead in some noisy crowd of people. I goes, where's Shannon? And she turned around and looked at me like. And I glanced down right then and realized I was still holding Shannon's hand. It had become so commonplace that I didn't even realize I was doing it anymore. But if you think about it, that's how God feels every time. He feels us pulling our hand out of His. All He wants to know is that you're okay, that you're going to be home come nightfall. You're safe. And He has done and is doing everything in His power to make sure that happens. Now, I started out quoting a song, and I'm going to end here by quoting from another musician, who would think. Anyway, this lady's name is Jenny Owens. Some of you may have heard of her. She's not super popular out there on all the radio stations or anything, but she's got some beautiful music. that I just have, it has spoken to me a lot. She was one of those child prodigies. She was able to pick out melodies, not just bang on a piano, but pick out melodies from songs before she could even form complete sentences. Pretty amazing lady. Sadly, before she, well, I guess it was in her third year, she went completely blind. And I don't know the history of that. All I know is she went blind. But that didn't stop her from enjoying music and pursuing it. And today, she is a musician. She is a lyricist. She is a composer. She is a, I think she's an assistant worship leader at a church. She has put out a number of albums. She has not only has done that, but she has authored some books. This, I believe, is her latest one. Great title, called Singing in the Dark. And the subtitle is Finding Hope in the Songs of Scripture. And it's a great book. I highly recommend it. You can find it online, I'm sure. Anyway, I like her, and so I had subscribed, or whatever you call it, to one of her blogs a while back. And this just came through, I believe, this last week. And I thought it was so fitting for what Carolyn and I were trying to say. And again, I think it's a God thing. Think about how the possibilities of all that. Okay, here we go. She says, everything we do matters. Again, going off of what Carolyn was saying. I've been thinking about that a lot since an experience a couple of weeks ago. I was visiting the Bowery Mission, a New York City organization that serves our neighbors without homes, offering meals, spiritual nourishment, and much more. I was there to prep for a team from our church, and before I left, I got to meet an old, decrepit, upright piano that Fanny Crosby, the 19th century blind hymn writer, had used to play when she came to the mission to serve years ago. Some of the keys don't play anymore, but it still has character. I could almost hear her singing, "To God Be the Glory." It struck me that most of us know about Mrs. Crosby because of her songs, but the Bowery remembers her because of her service. The simple, unromantic acts of sharing her heart and her time with people who were suffering. It reminds me that each of us is an unfolding story, always being read by those around us and by God. So every action, every choice we make matters. This realization moves me to pray that whatever work we do it passionately and wholeheartedly, as if we were serving Jesus himself, remembering how he served us. So live your story with hope. Even if you find yourself in a season of ordinary or mundane, or a moment of feeling unseen, take heart. God sees you, and likely others do too, who you don't even know are paying attention. But even if they don't, the most important eyes in the universe see you and love you. Whatever you do, and this is the verse that Jenny quoted, Colossians 3, 23 and 24, whatever you do, do your work heartily as for the Lord, rather than for men, knowing that from the Lord you will receive the reward of the inheritance. It is the Lord Christ whom you serve. And another verse, and again, it would be well to read the story around this. It's in 1 Samuel 12:24. It says, only fear the Lord and serve him in truth with all your heart, for consider what great things he has done for you. And I started this morning again with quotes from a song called My Story. I think he's the lyricist, the composer, and the performer of the song. He chose to use the chorus of Blessed Assurance in the middle of his song, kind of as what they call a bridge. And then he ended the song as well with these words, "This is my story. This is my song, praising my Savior all the day long.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchase of God, born of his Spirit, washed in his blood. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, perfect delight, visions of rapture now burst on my sight. Angels descending bring from above echoes of mercy, whispers of love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, all is at rest. I in my Savior am happy and blessed. Watching and waiting, looking above, filled with his goodness, lost in his love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long.
Let us bow our heads. Dear Heavenly Father, it's such a blessing to be here today, to be with you, and to be with my brothers and sisters, and to be with people who love you and adore you as much as I do. It's a blessing to hear this testimony. It's a blessing for people to share their stories, and to lift you up, and to praise you, Lord. I ask, Lord, that you send the Holy Spirit, that he be with all of us, that he join with us, and that we have a chance to pray and to be with you and to know you better. And the Holy Spirit come into our hearts and lift us up. And I pray, Lord, that we will always remember the blessings you've given us. You are our Creator. You are our Savior. You gave us the gift of grace. And now, Lord, I can say that we have a chance to be in heaven with you and be with you forever and ever. Oh, Lord, thank you for all the blessings you've given us. I ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.